Jesus, I love you. Oh my. And you are welcome in. You're welcome in this place. I'm loved.
Host Tracy Everette Duncan.
Your co-host right here, William Craig III.
I tell you, we're so excited to see you. It seems like it's been forever.
We're excited to see each other.
Well, that is true, too. Yeah. That is true. You know, it's always wonderful to see the tenants here. And William's always with me. He's the social health tenant. But tonight we have mental health. So we have Dr. Butler, who is going to talk to us about menopause. Charge it!
Men on pause.
Oh, well, hey, you know what? But come to think of it, you know, men also suffer from a form of menopause.
I wouldn't know.
She's going to talk about that tonight. Yes. And so no more cold sweat jokes. But we also have our author and speaker and host also.
Mr. That's Chop Dwayne Chop himself.
Ross with the Chop Chop. And yes, he is indeed here to talk to us tonight, too. So, you know, before we even introduce either one of them, let's say welcome.
Hello to Haiti.
Yes.
Peru.
Yes.
Japan. Iran, England, France, Russia, South Korea, all of you, we really appreciate you. We thank you so much for tuning in. And to my folks that have been retweeting me and following me, thank you so much. I really appreciate that. It means a lot to me.
All right. That is all 135 nations and all 50 states. Yes. Welcome to WLVS Radio.
We only do a few
Radio
at a time. The show's only an hour long.
Welcome to WLVS Radio. You're probably watching us through www.listenvisionlive.com or through MentorMe411.com. But, you know, let's not prolong because we got a lot to cover tonight. Yeah. And so let's bring on Dwayne Ross with the Chop Chop. Always
this
exciting.
This is
always
a kingdom.
That word breaking it down to, food that we can eat and absorb. So Dwayne Ross with the Chop Chop. Welcome.
All right, the Chop Chop is here. What do? We take the meat, we chop it up, we break it down, we take the meat of the word and make sure that people understand it. So, you know, today my topic is dealing with the heart. We were talking about the heart of the Father the last time we were together, and then we had a little snowstorm here and there. But what we're talking about today is the heart of the mom who actually supports the dream of the son. So I have a lot to talk to you about. I actually have a special guest, Ms. Leslie Wright. She's out there in the radio land, and she's going to be coming in. So I want to hit you real quick, though, with something that comes from Mr. Tupac Shakur. He made a really, really poignant moment when he said to his mom, "You know what? There's no way I could pay you back, but my plan is to show you that I understand." Mm-hmm. Sometimes moms don't know how appreciated they are. Mm-hmm. We're going to be coming from Proverbs 31. A virtuous woman who can find, and we'll be talking about it in a moment. But here, check out my man Tupac real quick.
Oh.
technical difficulty, but we got you're going to get you right back. Please so stand by. Mm-hmm. Please stand by. So the Proverbs 31 woman, virtuous woman who can find. There was this chart that said, you know, a 6-year-old is really like saying, "Where are you, mom? Come on to my heart. I love you, mom." But then as a moment, 16-year-olds, they were like, "Get out my face, mom. You're annoying me."
Wow.
But here's the thing. What happens when you get a chance to say, "Mom, I appreciate you. Here you go, mm-hmm. Tupac."
When I was pregnant in jail, I thought I was going to have a baby and the baby would never be with me, but I was acquitted a month and 3 days before Tupac was born. I was real happy because I had a son.
When I was young, me and my mama had beef, 17 years old, kicked out on the streets. Though back at the time, I never thought I'd see a face. Ain't a woman alive that could take my mama's place. Suspended from school, I'm scared to go home. I was a fool with the big boys breaking all the rules. Shed tears with my baby sister. Over the years we was poor than other little kids. And even though we had different daddies, the same drama when things went wrong, we blamed mama. I reminisce on the stress I caused. It was hell, hugging on my mama from a jail cell. And who thinking elementary? Hey, I see the penitentiary one day. Running from the police, that's right. Mama catch me, put a whooping to my backside. And even as a crack fiend, mama, you always was a black queen, mama. I finally understand for a woman it ain't easy trying to raise a man. You always was committed, a poor single mother on welfare. Tell me how you did it, there's no way I can pay you back. But the plan is to show you that I understand. You all.
Wow. Hey, so the plan was to show you that I understand. See, Proverbs 31 says she speaks with wisdom. And so many times people forget that mom has so much wisdom. True. And what kind of wisdom does a young man get when the father is gone? Mm-hmm. The only one he could depend on was his mama. Mm-hmm. And so many times you have to think back where was, when dad's not in the picture, what happens? Where does the dream go? What happens to the dreamer? Mm-hmm. Because see, she was a crack fiend, but she still held on. And he said, if you hold on, everything's going to be all right. See, sometimes we have to understand the virtuous woman that's in our moms. And as men, sometimes we're not even taught to look for virtuous women. We talk to look for hoochie mamas. Mm-hmm. We talk to look for, you know, curves and stacks.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But we don't always get taught to be looking behind that facade. What's really behind that woman?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And see, Proverbs 31 talks about how faithful. She's faithful in instruction. Mm. So a young man doesn't get instruction, he said he's going to make his mama sad. That's actually in Proverbs as well. Mm-hmm. It also talks about she watches over her affairs of the household and does not eat the bread of idleness. She's at work.
Yes.
And so if she's at work, she's going to teach him to be at work.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so young men, we need moms who have the virtuous aspects that are on the front cover of what they do on a regular basis. So many times we also have the young mother who doesn't have anyone speaking into her life, or maybe perhaps she didn't learn that she was virtuous. So she has 2 and 3 children by the time she's 15, 16 years old.
Right.
And now this young man is growing up in that household wondering, where's my image? You know, there's a statistic that says 64% are fatherless. In the United States. This is not color.
Right. Period.
It's not black or white.
Right. Period.
It's just fatherless. Mm-hmm. Without the biological father in the home. But the big part of that is, out of that 64%, 32% is African American. Mm-hmm. So 32% of African American households have vacant homes and they're vacant of biological fathers. So where are they getting the image?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So this today we want to talk to a mom who has sown image into her son. And this was a young man, and she's gonna talk about, her name is Miss Leslie Wright. And we met, and she does these events called vendor events. And Leslie, are you there? I can hear her. All right, I can't hear her in the studio. But Leslie, you know, I met your son because I was doing a guest speaking event. And I made a statement, and then your son, who I believe he was at the time, he's 6 years old or 5?
He's four, actually.
He's four. So talk about that moment and how you as a mom are engaged in helping him with his CEO status.
Right, well, sure, well, absolutely. First and foremost, thank you for having me on the show. And you really you came to an event that we have just completed, actually. I'm heading back up to South Carolina today, called Then to Win. And what we were doing was helping the people who've been that set up booths at trade shows have better relationships with the event coordinators and the people that put those events on. And you were one of my speakers in Raleigh, and you had mentioned and posed a question to the audience, you know, about what makes you unique when you're building your brand. And my son had had stepped up and said, God. And I think we were all pretty shocked, but he was very forthright in his answer. And it was kind of one of those moments as a parent where you're embarrassed because you wasn't expecting that response, but at the same time, you are very proud in the response, if that makes any sense.
Sure.
And so it was a good thing.
Right. So he made the connection between his inner image and God, which, again,
yeah.
Based on Proverbs 31, that's what a woman and a mother has to do. They have to show their son the God in him so that they can interact with this world the right way.
Right.
Because, see, if you don't help him understand his God image, then he's going to take on the image of all the other things that's in his vision. Mm-hmm. You know, television,
right.
Casted everything visions from people around them, maybe Joe Blow down the hall. Mm-hmm. Who might not be the right person that he should emulate. And then some of our actors and actresses and, you know, rappers and things of this nature, people of that nature. So the goal, if anything, is the Bible says in Proverbs 31, woman, she rises up early and her children call her blessed. Can you talk about how your son reverenced you as a mom?
It was actually pretty powerful. He's had several instances where people will, you know, stop me and say how great of a kid he is and that he is a direct reflection of what they know he's being taught at home. But probably one of the most recent moments is when his school was getting ready for Halloween. And much like my household, you know, we were taught to never shun other kids that celebrate Halloween. You know, you don't want to bust anybody else's bubble and their belief system. At home, but you are to train your children, you know, the way that you would like for them to go. And so we were in this heated discussion about whether or not we were going to celebrate it because obviously all of his friends were. And, you know, I explained to him that we were not, that we were going to go to a thing that many Christians are familiar with Hallelujah Night at church. And so I love where he goes to school because they do ask, you know, what celebrations does your child not need to celebrate? And we will figure out how to keep him incorporated without offending you. It's a really powerful system, and we're blessed for that at his school. And so he came home, and he said, well, Mom, I know what I want to dress up as. Is that okay? And I said, sure, you can dress up. You know, that's fine, and as long as it's appropriate. And he said, Mom, I want to be a businessman. I want to be a businessman like you. And I said, well, I'm a businesswoman, but I know what you're saying.
Yeah. Right.
And he went and he impressed everyone. He wanted his blazer, and we made him a briefcase, and I made him a fake mustache, and he had his glasses on and his hat. And you couldn't tell him anything until for Halloween or Halloween night, he went as a businessman. And I remember walking down the street because we walked from the school, and people would just stop and say, you know, what's going on? And he would be able to tell you at 4 years old that I'm a businessman today, and my name is Mr. Jackson.
All right.
So, yes. At 4 years old.
His name is Mr. Jackson, and I had to make sure I said, see you later, Mr. Jackson, and gave him a handshake. So I wanted to say thank you, Leslie, for I know that you're on the road. You just came from a phenomenal event, and now you're on your way to another one as well as getting back home. And if you had any one parting word in reference to vision that moms should have or support for their sons, what word would that be?
I would say faithfulness and attention. they go hand in hand. I think a lot of times as parents, you know, we want to shun our kids or we want to hush them up when they're talking too much. But a lot of times they will tell you what they will become. So be careful about how much you silence them, because they do know a lot more than what we give them credit for. And the things that they'll tell you that they want to be, don't laugh at them. Put them in programs and things that are going to help foster their gifts and talents, because they know better than us what they want to be in, and they start to get a sense of that very early on. So I would say attentiveness and faith, showing your child what it means to be in business or to have a vision, you know, show them all components of that, that the world may not understand them, but as long as, you know, their family and God understand them, that's what matters.
Amen. Thank you. Amen. Thank you so much. I do appreciate you, and we appreciate you. You know, I'll get back to you soon, and, you know, safe travels.
Bye.
Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you so much. If you can put up number one, slide number one. Because, see, here's the thing. She said a lot of stuff.
Yes.
But the thing that she talked about, that attentiveness, you know, you see some kids in certain neighborhoods, they have been given freedom to think. That the one that we talked about earlier. And so
next slide.
Next slide, please. Mm-hmm. Yeah. See, Mama knew. In my book, No More Crumbs from the Table, I talk about how moms, they know stuff intrinsically. Mm. And a lot of times, you know, society says, you know, shut them down, put them in a seat, make sure they don't move too much. You know, your son talks a lot. Your daughter, she does this. So here's the thing. If we can identify these things, mm-hmm. then we can help build them up. And the Bible talks to us about building each other up on our own most holy faith. But what about building our children up on their most holy faith, mm-hmm. so they can have a vision internally that now we show them on the outside how to actually access it? You know, she talked about being attentive to what they're enjoying, what they're involved in. Right. And I think that was really, really mm-hmm. key. So in my book, I talk about how my mom, you know, I'm just going to read a real excerpt. You know, there was a situation going on where this young kid was riding past in my neighborhood, and I was in Tennessee at the time, and I was 5 years old. But he called me a derogatory name, mm-hmm. the N-word. And I got very upset, and it was a powerful word, but anger kind of took over. And at the time, the young boy rode his bike past me. He shouted this terrible word, and in an instant, we were entangled in a very fierce hatred. Blow after blow, we began to settle the account in a primitive manner. We were fighting. In a haze, my memory can only recall the deep scratches that were inflicted on my face, the arms, and the shoulder. There were deep bleeding scratches mixed in with sweat and finally big alligator tears. I was giving up. I didn't want to fight anymore. I didn't want to prove anything. I just wanted it all to stop. He was about 8 years old and I was about 4 or 5. Surely everybody would understand the young kid running from the big kid. I ran fast as I could to my mama, crying and shuddering. And she was sitting on the stoop. And mama gave me 35 cents. She put a quarter in one hand and a dime in the other hand and said, "Don't you lose my money. Now go back out there and show that boy who you are." Now, I don't want to say that, you know, we should encourage, you know, negativity or anger or anything like that. But at that moment, that was a defining moment for me as a little boy, knowing that I need to stick up for myself. And in my neighborhood, you had to fight. So the questions was answered. Mama believed in me. She knew that I can do it. And then she gave me something tangible, the quarter and the dime. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes it might be the briefcase. In her case, she gave him a briefcase,
right.
and a mustache and a hat,
right.
and a business card. Mm-hmm. You know, and said, "He's a CEO." Mm-hmm. And that mentality, that message will continue to play in his mind.
For sure.
Mm-hmm. All right, next slide. So the Proverbs 31 woman, she... You know, we talked about this statistic, but one of the things that's there says 9.2% of which is due to incarceration. Mm-hmm. That's another issue that's affecting our young boys and their vision. And moms are incarcerated now.
Yes, that's right. That's correct.
That's right.
So who's raising our babies?
Yeah. That's right.
Who's giving them the image? Grandma. maybe grandpa. And if it's old school grandma and grandpa, grandpa's probably back in the cut. Because he was taught hands off. Let mama take care of the kids. So what's going on with our children? If we're not doing certain things, we're probably going to be looking at some a lot of individuals not actually accessing their greatest gift. Mm-hmm. And then last slide, next slide, please. We talked about the charm. Charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting. But a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Mm-hmm. See, right before that said, many women do noble things, but you surpass them all.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of nobility. There's a lot of cool things going on in the community. Excuse me. But the nobleness of a Proverbs 31 woman, she's breaking things down. She's sharing different opportunities. She's putting them in environments that build and shape and allowing their mindset to be engaged. She's allowing him to write, even though he doesn't even know all the words. She's allowing him to have conversations with other people and shake hands firmly and walk up to people and ask them for things. You know, the interesting thing is that these are the same traits that CEOs must have as they venture out into the world. They have to be able to engage different types of people. They can't just be with their own, you know, hanging out. Right. And they have to know how to be, in some cases, bicultural, move in and out of different cultures, maybe multicultural, right?
That's right.
They have to now be global.
That's right.
Yes.
Because you got to do business with people in other countries. Yep. You know, we had 135 right now nations that we're talking with. So somebody might be saying, hey, I need you to come to Zimbabwe.
That's right.
Well, do we know how to engage that? And then, of course, you know, we were talking about the heart of moms, you know, because last time we talked about the heart of dads. What is so cool is that when you have a child that has this vision to be whatever he or she says she wants to be, isn't it awesome that mom can connect the dots? Put people in different environments and let the dots and let the situations kind of enhance their dream. You know, I kind of remember one thing that happened in third grade, and then I'm getting ready to close, but I said I wanted to be a dentist. We had to do a vision board in third grade and tell people, what are you going to do when you grow up? And I came home, but see, my mom was gone. I had no mom, and my dad was gone. So the only person I could tell was my grandfather, who was a mason, masonry work, you know, and he was a pastor by then, you know. And I just remember there wasn't nobody else that I could tell. My teacher. But it, you know what? It didn't, it wasn't engaged. And that just sat dormant for many, many, many years. And I never even thought about it until I was preparing for this. And I was like, you know,
wow.
In third grade, I did say I wanted to be a dentist. So what happened with that dream? What happened to that vision? What happened to that idea? It died. So anyway, this is the Chop Chop. It seemed like a little heavy in here.
I thought that too.
What's going on? So I mean, what's your experience with... what's your experience with anything?
Well, my experience, thinking about what you said, the things that I thought that I would be growing up, I am becoming, but when I speak, I'm speaking to two different kingdoms. I'm speaking to the kingdom of this world and then the kingdom of our God. And you'll hear the testimony next month. Actually, all of you will hear our testimony where God has brought us from next month. And mine is remarkable because I thought that I was going to be a high priestess witch over a covenant of witches. And so that's what I was going for. But instead, God delivered me at 12 years old. He did a lot of things to save my life because I was supposed to have been dead by 12 years old.
Wow.
And he's making me a Christian woman over a myriad of women, whether they are saved or not, to bring them into the kingdom.
So, same vision, but the kingdom vision.
Yes, yes.
Totally different focus.
Yes. And that's the other thing too. You know, a lot of young men, they get, you know, caught up. And you and I, we work with workforce development, and we know that we could take a drug dealer and turn him into a CEO.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Because he actually has to think like a CEO. Sure. He has to think about how his customer is being supported and served.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, so we have to look at these negative things and see if we can take it and just kind of redirect it.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, make it more of a kingdom vision. Mm-hmm. Instead of a worldly vision.
It is. I honestly do believe that God speaks to us in the womb, that we have had a conversation with him about what we are supposed to be and do, and then we walk out of his presence into this world,
right, and
we are to perform. Right. And somewhere along the line, we get wrapped up into the things of this world and get distracted.
The cares of the world.
Yes, and we get off.
Right,
but
off track.
In
but
our upturn, moving. That's right, in the upturn is where we pass all that stuff, get back in alignment with God and fulfill the vision, because we're not going anywhere until we do.
Right. It's, you know, some people think, well, Tupac, you know, he died early. Yeah, but look what the legacy he left on the earth.
Yes.
Look at the stamp that he left.
Yes.
You know, we talk about Bruce Lee. You know, Bruce Lee was 32.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
You know, but look what he left on the earth. We're still having commercials with him jumping through the air.
That's right.
So, you know, if it's divine and it's from the kingdom, it's going to happen.
It's going to happen.
And there's nothing or no one that can get in the way.
Mm-hmm.
And even ourselves can't get in the way, because something will impact us and bring us back in alignment. You talked about alignment.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And see, that alignment is so true, because, you know, I talk about how even this book, it sat on the shelf for a few years. Because I was so busy with the cares of the world, you know, doing my job.
Right.
And then God woke me up one day and said, you know, I gave you this gift.
Mm-hmm.
You might want to brush it off.
You know, and that's part of the piece when you talk about the mom. Because one of the images you had on there of the virtuous woman was an image with a woman who was a black silhouette with words, full of words. And then when I saw that, immediately what came to me was, she has to be full. There it is. She has to be full of the word.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Because if she's full of the word,
she's
able to nurture you as a young man, even as a young woman. But as a young man, she's able to nurture you in the word. And the word tells us that when you do that, that word will not depart from it.
Right. It will not return to you void.
It won't return to God void.
It
will accomplish
that which
it
was sent to do.
Exactly.
And as you said earlier, you said you think that, you know, God spoke to us in the womb. And I had this epiphany one time where it felt like, even before the womb, he said, I knew you
before
the womb.
Yes.
You know, Jeremiah, right? And he said, hey, so, you know, he was really walking with us in heaven. And he gave us our assignment. He said, now, here's the thing. You're going to go back in the womb.
That's right.
You're going to come out, but you're not going to know anything else.
That's, isn't that what he did?
Except for my voice.
Right. Isn't that what he did?
And he speaks to us all the time. Some people say, well, you know, you will lose it. No, and even opportunities. Opportunities don't just come and go.
Mm-hmm.
Opportunities always come.
It's a cycle.
They cycle through.
Yes.
Oh my gosh. You know what? We could go on and on about this. But I think we're running into Dr. Michelle's time. But I do want to pick this up again. I do want everyone to know who we are. And being the next month, Easter and the Sabbath and the resurrection and everything, we want you to hear why we say that we're unafraid, why we say that we're born again, we're Christ-like. I mean,
fearless,
just the testimony is enough where God has brought us from.
Yeah.
You would have thought we'd quit, or people like us in that situation would have quit.
Yeah.
But no, for some reason, he has birthed in us the will to live according to his purpose and his plan. And we're not going anywhere until you come on with us.
That's right.
Okay? So, you know, let's do a shift just real quick. I loved what you talked about. I really want to have her and her 9-year-old son on again.
Yes, yes. I want him to talk. Well, actually, he was 4 because my 9-year-old son, Brett, he was at another event and unable to call in.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to call someone else, because I actually have this eye. I always look for little kids doing better or doing more than what some other kids are doing. I was just at a restaurant, and this kid was saying he's designing his own laptop.
Okay, okay.
And I said, okay, well, you get it together because I got a show. I
yes,
need you
let's,
to bring
it. Let's bring them
around.
We want
to bring
table.
That vision, mm-hmm. you know, forward. So, but that's what happened.
Okay.
And so she was my second guest because, you know, if you
but
have
she
a
was
guest,
the perfect one.
You want to make right. sure you she have somebody. One. Actually, she's the one.
Yes.
And Leslie Wright, I just want to thank you again out there. And I know that, you know, she's on fire doing many good things. So.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, indeed. Thank you.
Well, okay, we've got Dr. Michelle in the studio.
Yes, we do.
And we have an important message that we're going to talk about tonight. Menopause, charge it. Now, let me tell you something. I love my studio engineer. He hears my cry. Get the fan on because I'm hot. And so the fan blows on me just before we open up the segment for you. But it's because, you know, I have those symptoms of menopause. Yes, I know I don't look that old, but
God is good. That's that. I'm sure we'll talk about it, but yeah. that's one of the misgivings about
yes,
menopause.
That is
that
true.
It's an old woman's disease or a condition.
It is not.
And it is not.
No, no. As a matter of fact, menopause, the average age, you all tickle me, the average age of any woman having or beginning menopause is 47 to 51 years old. However, there are young girls as early as 30 years old,
that's
and
right.
some are now even experiencing menopause while they're in their latter teens and early young women stages.
The doctor is chomping at the bit.
Yes, she is. Can't wait
here.
To get going. So let us introduce our co-host, Dr. Michelle.
Ta-da. Well, hello out there in TV land.
Okay.
Hi, William.
Hello, Dr. Michelle.
Hi, Tracy.
Hello.
Hello there. Okay, you know what? Menopause is a wonderful subject to talk about because most women don't even understand what menopausal is. Mm-hmm. We have the symptoms of menopause, but we don't quite understand what menopausal is. So, menopause is this. Oh, look at that.
Mm-hmm.
Menopause is defined as the absence of menstrual periods for 12 months. It is the time when a woman's life, when function of ovaries has ceased.
Mm-hmm.
And why that's true, because we are born with millions and millions and millions of eggs. And through puberty, they, hundreds drop. We have the babies, then more drops. They increase and get less and less and less until we have no more eggs left, mm-hmm. AKA we are in menopause. Mm-hmm. And then how do you know when you're in menopause? When your cycle has stopped for a whole year,
mm-hmm.
no okay. more period. That says to us that you are in menopause. That says to us, no more babies, Chickie.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you do have a small percentage of women that can still ovulate,
mm-hmm.
and you get one
Sarah?
Slipped in there,
Sarah,
right?
Sarah,
Sarah
was thinking, I was thinking,
but that was because we were supposed to live forever. In this flesh.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
So yeah, so Sarah is one of them,
Elizabeth.
And every now and then you exactly.
Yes.
Well, that just goes
right.
to show you how God, in His infinite mindset,
he's
was
in control.
We are so he's in control,
mm-hmm.
and we were supposed to live forever,
mm-hmm.
but because of sin,
right.
we no longer live forever
in this world,
but in the spirit, we live
yeah.
forever, so
mm-hmm.
we have everlasting life.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah! However,
okay,
so here's the average age of menopause, 47 to 51, 51. But menopause does occur as early age as early as 30s and late 60s. I know for me,
right.
menopause started at 39.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse my voice, y'all. I have a little challenge with my voice. Hope you can hear me. But personally for me, I started menopausing or premenopausing at 39. I started with these hot flashes
right.
During the day, and I didn't know what was going on. I was having a lack of concentration.
Mm-hmm.
I was having mood swings, you know, up and down and here and there and everywhere. You know, by the time I'm outside hot, come inside, I'm cold,
mm-hmm.
you know, all kinds of things, fatigued, you know, because we experience fatigued. You know, in the memory loss, I mean, one minute I saw the keys, the next minute they were gone.
Okay.
You know, and then we're asking everybody, where's the keys? And mad at them because they can't find the keys, and we need to find the keys. You know?
And they're in your hand, right?
Yeah, they're in the hand.
And there they go.
They're right here.
And the same thing with the glasses. And most women can understand that. Where are my glasses? Oh my God, I can't find my glasses. And they're either tucked in the in the collar of your shirt, or they're sitting there on top of your head. That's menopause. And you know what, men, husbands, you guys have got to, you got to walk alongside with us when we're in menopause. Because menopause for women is a wonderful, wonderful God-given change that we experience as a woman.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I understand. But I don't see the benefit in us. You're always bitchy. Well, yeah, I am bitchy. It's because I am going through menopause. You try being in this body. Okay, where the blood vessels are heated up. You know, the blood vessels, you know, it has some type of sensation in the skin, you know, where it's causing the body temperature to raise up. Just, you know, the body temperature is raised up. And now we got, and so we're experiencing hot flashes. Mm-hmm. It is so an uncomfortable experience. It is. You don't know how it is. But let me tell you something, men.
Men.
I'm about to go there with you.
I said the men.
Can you hear the passion? Men.
Can you hear
the men go through what you call passion. Male menopause.
Yes.
Okay. AKA, what you call that? Midlife crisis. Mm-hmm. You know what?
Yes.
I watched my father go through midlife crisis. He went out there, he bought a car. This is at about 50. Okay. He bought a car. All of a sudden, he changed his whole look about himself. Okay. With all these clothes. You know, did all these other things that you would not think a man would do. Mm-hmm. He was doing them. Okay, so men go through the same thing. Yes, you do. You go through mood swings.
Yes.
You go through depression. Yes, you do. You go through anxiety. Mm-hmm. And you have a loss of libido, just like a woman. And you have, you know, you have symptoms, other symptoms like headaches and fatigues and things like that. But you too go through menopause. It's called andropause.
Yes.
You go through the same
thing. They didn't teach
andropause. No, never heard that.
Yeah, and they won't. There it is right there.
And there it is right there. You guys lose it.
Oops. That's what it is. There it is.
That's what's going on.
Hey, it's all about you guys' ego. When it comes to the andropause. I'm sorry, I do not have a scripture on that.
That's all right.
We don't either.
No, I didn't put a scripture.
I'm just glad I am not there. That's all
right. Right, right, right.
Follow
him. We're fearfully and wonderfully made too.
Fearfully and wonderfully made. So yeah, so you see, mind, body, and sexual function is what happens to men, and the same equally as it happens to women, because we all go through this change of life. This is God-given. Mm-hmm. And for women, we lose the eggs to produce. Mm-hmm. Okay? For men, you guys just, it's about your ego.
And the testosterone.
And your testosterone, right, and the testosterone.
Well, they tell you that you're losing testosterone, right?
You lose testosterone, right.
From 20-something. Right. And then it just keeps going down and down and down.
Exactly. So God, well, and that is due to sin. Because we were meant to live forever, you know. And so now because of sin, this flesh goes through a change, and it's constantly changing.
Right.
And for women, we're constantly changing because we bring forth life.
Okay.
You know, and because we bring forth life, our bodies, we can't keep having babies all the time. Yeah. I mean, Eve probably would have been having babies after babies after babies after babies.
Right.
You know, if sin had to come in,
world.
Populated the whole world. But unfortunately, it didn't work that way. You know, so here we are. We experience menopause. We're menopausal, and we go through all these symptoms. And you know what? And through menopause, it's a time for us to be gathered around our families, you know, and experience more love and more peace. Because by the time we're in menopause, we've already had our children. Now we're embracing our grandchildren.
Yep.
And life says to us that it's wonderful because we have contributed much to it.
But I'm seeing a lot of marriages where they're remarried now at 45, close to that menopause age, and they're having their first baby with this new husband. So what's happening?
So, like I said before, you do have a very small percentage, and I do not have the answer to that. That one we will have to take a prayer and ask God about. But there, you do have a very small percentage that have not lost all those eggs. Right. Mm-hmm.
But wait a minute.
I'm just talking about how they're going to go through that change. But they also just had that baby early, you know, at the last part of
it. Now, I can say my sister, in her season, growing in her season, she had a baby. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, it's like she just skipped through menopause for a period of time. Yeah. You know, something happens when you have that baby and it's your onset to have menopause.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It just doesn't happen because the hormones.
The hormones. Mm-hmm. There are 80%. Yeah. There is an 80% chance of 80% of women that or 20% of women that can still have a baby during menopause. 80% of us have lost.
So what should
eggs.
The guys do to prepare themselves?
be nice.
That's right.
Be nice, Williams.
Be nice.
Be
you
nice.
Know what? There are more.
More flowers.
Go to dinner more often. Let's have a cook.
More date night.
Yeah. Hello.
Yes.
Do you know that there are more women incarcerated because they don't understand the woman going through menopause?
Well, the Twinkie defense.
And she has. Wow. I'm telling you, we in menopause, we go through so much mentally, and they mistake this crime, and they don't take that crime to a point to look at her total mental and her total anguish and how and why she got to where she got to. Well, and a lot of it stems from menopause.
But look at, I mean, there's a slide on the statistics. There are 6,000 women going through menopause every day in the United States. That is 2,190,000 women going through menopause. And no one's talking about it.
And nobody's talking about it. And I like to say, you know what, for the women that are in incarcerated during this time, you know what? Be blessed. We are sorry that society has not looked at you a little closer than what they should have looked at you, because maybe, just maybe, you know, you will not be in the place that you're in. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's consequences to every crime met.
Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
However, just maybe if someone would have taken a little bit more extra time to look at where you were in your change of season, then things may would have panned out
differently. So there's a lawyer
out
there that really needs to hone in on this and start to investigate.
Yes.
Because just as you can have a guilty by reason of insanity, what I'm hearing you say, that there needs to be a guilty by reason of menopause in some cases.
That's nice. kudos for you, Will.
Well, at least get the conversation started, because you know, and then Andrew Paul is sliding in there, and the brother's like going off, and you're like, what the world is happening? You got Andrew Paul, menopause happening.
Everybody pause.
Hey, Mike, flip that next slide, because we want to really look at the symptoms that men are going through.
What's the matter, Mike?
This is what's happening to men.
Whenever you see that, when you see men all the time doing excessive sweating, and you look at him and you go, oh, maybe he's, you know, got too much weight on him,
low,
and things like that.
High blood pressure.
Okay, some of that may be true, but a lot of that, find out how old he is. Because libido, I mean, because andropause for men starts about 35.
Yes, it does.
It starts about 35 years old.
What's going on? Wait a minute.
And that's the time where you thinking, okay, maybe I need to man up. But then you need to be careful, because manning up can get you in trouble. Oh, how your eyes will wander they're not supposed to be going during andropause. So, AKA, you get in trouble.
So this is, I'm sorry. This is interesting. This is why then men who have been married for long periods of time,
all of a sudden,
she's not good enough for me anymore. I want somebody younger.
What you see is happening right now with one particular person. I can't say his name. I don't know if that matters. But he decided, I don't want to be a man. I'm just.
Right.
That's in the headlines right now.
Well, that sounds like another show. Maybe he had so much
menopause, he switched over to menopause.
But anyway.
But so it's a natural occurrence. Right. You know, and people ask me all the time, okay, so what can we do to, you know, subside? Well, hormone replacement therapy is popular. But I would take the natural approach.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know, because again, this is a God-given change of season that all humans go through, as you can see, andropause, menopause.
Right.
Okay, pause, stop, no more. Right. We're going to take a change in another direction. Mm. That's what it is.
You know what comes to me right there, because I think about fasting, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
And so all the pains and things that you go through when you're fasting. But part of what happens is when you're fasting, you're able to get focused more on your relationship with God. And so when you just said that, everything pauses and everything's supposed to pause.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost as if he's saying, okay, stop.
Take a break.
Yes.
Take
yes.
a break.
Yes.
And now tune into me. Mm-hmm. Get close to me, because the season that you're about to go through is just before the season where more than likely you're going to get to see me.
Isn't that right?
Okay.
And what's so really funny about it is in the halfway mark, for real, at that 50,
mm-hmm.
50, you know, because God says he's going to give us 120. Okay,
right.
So right there at that 50 mark, for real, is where he says, this pause.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we don't want to take a whole lot of medication for that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I personally, as a naturopath, I would not really suggest that. But there are some diet changes. You know, there's some natural herbal remedies that we can incorporate in the diet, not to minimize or not to take away those symptoms.
But slow the process.
Because
down.
you can't slow the process
down.
Just
to make it bearable.
Just to make it bearable.
Yeah.
You know, so
it's kind of like when you get the migraines things, and you remove the dairy and then all the things that become triggers.
Exactly. Like dairy, you know, things like dairy has a tendency to rise up, you know, make us a little flushed, you know, get the body hot, you know, spicy foods for women, you know, and for men, you know, have a tendency to get the flesh a little hot, and we get rised up and a little cranky and irritable. You know, it, for men, too much soy. For women, not enough soy. You know, things like that. You know, eating more raw fruits and foods, you know, more, what I'm going to say, alkaline foods than acid foods, you know, to cause the body from rising up, because it's all symptomatic. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's all hormonal, you know, and just, you know, just keeping life for yourself, keeping the stress down as much as possible, you know, and you just did it. You took a deep breath, you know, take a deep breath and relax, you know, soothe the mind, soothe the body. When you slow down, when you take a deep breath, you slow the mind, you slow the body, you know, little things like that will help you. So I don't really recommend the hormone replacement therapy when you're talking about, you know, doing the medication. They used to give women, and I may be getting in a little trouble with this, but they used to give women Primarium, if I'm saying that right, PR. And what that is, Primarium, what that is, it's horse urine. Mm-hmm. So it's in the hormones of the horse urine, you know, that they would give women, you know, to subside those their hormones. You know, you have to make your choices, you know, on what it is that you want to take.
Yeah.
But again, menopause and andropause is a natural process mm-hmm. that God has given us on these bodies so that we can change focus, just as William says, change the focus in our lives and reset ourselves and come back to enjoy. I mean, we have an opportunity to look at our lives, and now in the second half of our lives, we get the opportunity to look at it and say, wow, look what I've done.
Yes.
Look where I've came from.
Look where I can go.
Look
where I can go.
And at this point in life, at our 50s, it doesn't matter whether you've given birth to those children, but we're all grands of those children. Mm-hmm. And in this season of our lives, you know, we have enough wisdom and enough knowledge to give these individuals. Mm-hmm. So, and that's how I see menopause affording us, you know.
That's great.
We are grand people.
Yes, we are.
You know, we are grand people. Yes. You know, and menopause offers that to us.
But, you know, you talked also, though, about those that are younger who are going through this process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so if they're younger in their 30s to the early 40s, what are some of the things that they're able to do to, you know, impact that future? Because now they're, you know, they're looking at us saying we're older, and I don't want to be old. I don't want to go through that. But it's natural.
Mm-hmm. But you know, it sounds it to me. I'm seeing this in a totally new light today.
Oh, good.
Because really, it's a gift. Mm-hmm. And the problem I think that we have oftentimes with most areas of growth is that it hurts. Mm-hmm. If it didn't hurt,
but it's a gift of change.
Here we go, and that's just that's it. Right. If it just like when our legs grow and our arms grow, you know, your kids sometimes they cry at night. You take them to the doctor. And the doctor says, "Oh, they're just growing. They're growing pains, right? And so it's almost the same thing here with menopause. It's a level of growth. It's growing pains, and I see it now more as a gift. So here we go. And as much as a woman who's 32 doesn't want to hear necessarily that she's going through menopause.
Or a guy going through andropause at an early age because, you know, you have.
Look at the opportunity that they are being afforded, that they're able now to stop and make the shift so that those latter years can be, as the Bible says, the greater years.
Yes, that's embrace the kids to embrace them.
They don't have as many mistakes that they now have to make.
Exactly.
You know? But you had a comment, Dwayne.
It's fine. It's just that, you know, you have this younger generation who are looking at our, you know, next generation or the older generation saying, you know, you guys are slow. You guys have, you know, you're not involved in as much activities and things of this nature. But if this is happening to them at a younger age, they're going through this as well, and they're slowing down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, and as you said, William, they, you know, they get the chance to, you know, transition. But, you know, will they be looking at it as a blessing or are they looking at it as a curse? Because they're looking at it as a negative.
Because that's what society has taught us. And again, it wasn't until this conversation that I even am beginning to understand this better.
Mm-hmm. No one is talking to them in the home. What is happening is that they're seeing it and experiencing it in the home by the one that's throwing out the negativity in action.
Mm-hmm.
See, so if you have a husband in the home, if you have a menopausal woman in a home, menopausal mother in a home, and she's spewing out this stuff, she knows she's in menopause, but she don't really understand.
Exactly.
Because our mothers really didn't explain it. I remember when I first recognized my symptoms, I went into the doctor's office. I knew I was going through menopause, but I needed for the doctors to confirm it. Mm-hmm. Okay, because Michelle was in tune with Michelle. Because I watched my mother go through menopause like crazy.
The change of
life. My father was ready to commit, change of life. He was ready to commit her because he couldn't understand the craziness was going on.
Right.
Only later for my mother to tell me, Michelle, you've got to tell the world about menopause, honey. You've got to tell. So here you have a menopausal woman in the home, mother, and then you have a husband who don't have a clue.
The children
are looking at this going, huh?
Right.
And they don't have a clue because more is caught than taught.
Right. Mm-hmm. And see, here's the thing, too.
Oh, we also got our...
Oh, is it yeah, time to go already? Is. Come on, well, now. We okay, have 5 minutes. No, okay. But the reality is that they don't have to slow down. No. And when I look at some of the heroes that you know have gone before,
they were working.
They worked themselves into the grave. To the grave. In fact, there's a gentleman that I know to this day. One of his favorite sayings is, "I'd rather wear out than rust out."
Right.
You know.
Right.
So it doesn't mean that the change has to cause you to rust out. That you got to slow down. It just, I think, again, helps refocus your position. It refocuses the goal. It refocuses the destiny call. And that's something that I've been...
But that's the point. That's the point. They're not being taught about the destiny call. And they're rusting out because they're thinking, I'm done. Yeah. My life is out of whack. I don't know what I'm going to do. And we have to have this conversation and bring it back to
about us.
Gift, that talent, that ability.
Yeah, so we need to...
There's so much you can do too.
I was getting ready to say we need to have a seminar, ladies.
Yeah, and men.
And men. And your pause.
And your pause. I learned a new word today.
And we all come together and let's talk about how to address this whole change of life.
Mike, you gonna sign up for
how many men ever heard of andropause?
Nobody.
You know, and you guys out there in 135 countries, let us know about what you think about this andropause.
Yeah.
We need to have a conversation.
Give me a call.
Our sons are not hearing andropause.
How do you say it in Japanese?
But we're seeing the commercial where they had testosterone enhancements and now they're having heart problems.
And if you want to know, it's a hormone testing that I do.
Yes.
And if you want to get your hormones tested, give me a call,
Visit your website.
Or visit my website, and we can get those hormones tested. It's not a way out cost. Just come on and let's get the hormones tested and see where you're at. You'll love it.
Mm-hmm, because when you do get it tested, I haven't done it yet. I do plan on doing that because I'm an avid believer in everything that Dr. Mm-hmm. Michelle stands for. She can also tell you what you need as far as nutrient supplements, exercises, diet, the whole thing to balance you off it doesn't hurt as much.
Yes, doesn't hurt at all.
Well, the menopausal and the andropausal symptoms.
Oh, non-abrasive.
Yeah. Yes. So you can reach Dr. Michelle through MentorMe411.com. Yes. She has a bio there. You can click on that and send her an email, or you can click on her bio and go right to her website, which is
naturalwellness.com.
And when you visit her website, see, I've been all over it. When you visit her website, she has the information that talks about hormones and hot flashes and things like that. And now that we know that they also occur in men, we expect to hear and receive a lot of information from the people to you about that.
There's a website. There is a video on my website that talks about menopausal women and andropausal men.
All right.
That'll bring you into it.
Wow.
So let me say, guys could actually be for reason of instead of guilty. Insanity.
Dwayne, you are in
for reason
andropause.
Of andropause.
Deny it all you want.
So now we got. We got to look at this because how many young men are incarcerated?
As a
result.
Well, we're going to pick this up. We're going to look. We're going to be back next week.
It wasn't my fault, honey.
It wasn't me.
I was andropause.
It was andropause.
Well, we're going to continue this after we sign off. But for now, we need you to be safe,
be smart, be healthy.
Bye-bye.
Bye.